Now that it gets dark rather early, I decided to replace an outdoor light fitting with one of these bulkhead lights with integrated passive infrared or PIR motion detect sensors. I decided on this one because I have similar ones installed at a different place some 2 years ago and it's working flawlessly. This would be hardly worth a video, but the new one is very different in design from the previous one. It comes well protected in its box and with the usual reasonably useful multi-language installation sheets. I got mine from Screwfix, which is a UK hardware retailer. As you can see, the LED light itself is included in the bulkhead light and rated as 8 watts. While the previous models looked almost identical, the big difference is that the old model has a standard E27 lamp socket into which you could insert any type of mains rated light bulb, incandescent up to 60 watts or LED based, as I have done. In the new fixture, the LED panel is integrated and non-replaceable. Not something I like to see, but in this case I'm pretty confident I could repair or replace the LED panel if I need so I'm not too worried. On the plus side, the trouble with the interchangeable lamp in the old style model was that since the translucent cover has to be removed for lamp installation, there was always the danger of rainwater making its way through the tiny gap between the cover and the housing. I actually smeared silicone sealant around the gap after putting the bulb in, which is a bit messy but so far kept it dry. As with the previous style lamp, the PIR sensor is permanently integrated into the lamp housing, but it can be swiveled left and right, as well as down for a couple of degrees. The dials for adjusting the light sensitivity and on time are on the bottom of the PIR sensor. According to the installation sheet, the time ranges from 10 seconds to 4 minutes. The time interval restarts if another movement is detected while the light is on. As with the previous style lamp, using on-off sequences, it's possible to override the sensor. Through the frosted lid, you can just make out a circuit board with two rows of 6 LEDs. I have to disappoint you if you want to see the inside, because I'm still going to mount this and I want to find out how well this design seals against the weather. Should it fail, I promise that I will open and report on it. The rear of the housing has this strange loop. There's a solitary screw on the right side of the lamp and a push button on the left. After consulting the manual, it turns out that the screw on the right side must be accessible for installation. Depending on where you want to mount it, this could be a bit of an issue because you need to leave sufficient space on the right side of the light to get a screwdriver in. So, no mounting close to corners or door frames. With the screw removed, the reason for the loop becomes clear. You need to pull on the back while pressing the button in. This will then release the mounting panel. As you see, the lamp body is completely sealed and only 3 pins stick out to connect to the mounting panel. A rather interesting approach, clearly designed to keep water out. The small mounting panel is the only part you are actually screwing to the wall and connect the electricity to. It is really hard for the camera to get a good look at this because it's all shiny, reflective black plastic. There's a thermal block marked live, earth and neutral, and a strain relief leading to a rubber grommet for the cable inlet that still needs to be pierced. The same is true for the mounting holes that are indented but not yet open. The part where the mounting panel connects is just having the 3 pins that slide into the thermal block and 2 plastic guide pins. No openings or screws anywhere. I would not be surprised if this unit is glued together. As I said, further investigation into the inside will have to wait until the light fails for some reason. But I will test it, of course, on the bench, and for that I connected temporarily a mains cable. The panel clicks into the body and There's a cable guide that allows the cable to exit towards the bottom right of the light. That is the only way for a surface mounted cable to go. Of course, if the cable comes out of the wall, you may be able to install the mounting panel so that the cable inlet grommet sits right over where the cable emerges. For the test, I'm using my power monitor I built in one of the previous videos. Okay, so we have about 8 watts real power with a power factor of around 0.56. The 8 watts are right what the spec promised. After initial power on, the installation manual says the light will be on for around 50 seconds and then go into the sensor mode. 50 seconds or so later the light goes off. I'm shielding the sensor and moving my hand at the same time triggers the sensor to get it back for a short period of time of slightly more than 10 seconds. So all this works as it should. Slightly surprising for me is a look at the power monitor while the light is off. Still almost 1 watt when the light is off and at an even worse power factor. That is worryingly high. Let me explain. Here are the displays of the power monitor for the two cases. The top one shows what's happening when the light is on. The light uses about 8 watts of real power, which at the current average price per kilowatt hour in the UK will cost you £10 if you leave the light on for 1 year, 24 hours, day and night, 7 days a week. Below is the case when the light is off and only the PIR is running. It draws 0.91 watts, which will cost you £1.15 per year. Now you will probably agree that it's extremely unlikely that the light will be on anywhere close to 24 hours 7 days for a year, but that means it's therefore equally likely that it's off for rather close to a year. After all, it can only be either on or off unless you bought the Schrödinger model. So it seems in terms of your yearly electricity bill, the off state and hence the power consumption of the PIR matters more than the on state with the LEDs at full blast. Don't you find it an eye-opener that you pay more than 1/10 of the price of the light being fully on permanently day and night for the convenience of having it come on for 30 seconds or so for the few times you walk past it during the night? Things get exceedingly worse if you have been blessed with a smart meter and get charged for apparent power. The power companies argue that they have to size the grid and generators not only for providing real power to you, but also for the additional reactive power which your device continuously draws from the grid and then pushes back into the grid without ever using it. The vector sum of real and reactive power is called apparent power, and to distinguish it from real power measured in watts, it's commonly expressed at volts ampere or VA, and reactive power as volt ampere reactive or VAR. You can get apparent power by dividing the real power by the power factor, or in the case of my power monitor, you can also multiply the volts and amp readings for the same result. The power factor is the cosine of the angle between the real power and the apparent power. Obviously, if the power factor is 1, the angle is 0, the vectors of apparent power and real power are equal and on top of each other, and the reactive power is 0. Obviously, this is not the case here, whether the light is on or off. A non-unity power factor is common nowadays with all kinds of LED lights, and capacitor droppers or switch mode power supplies are in practical all consumer electronics, so the power companies have a point in that ignoring apparent power is no longer sustainable, nor is continuously bouncing off lots of reactive power around the grid particularly environmentally friendly. Your device may not consume it, but there are losses in the cables having to carry it unnecessarily. Well, assuming they would charge me for apparent power and the price per kilowatt hour stays the same regardless whether it's apparent or real, which is hopefully not how things will end up, but you never know, you are now looking at £18 for the light to be permanently on for a year, almost double from what it was before. But for the off state, it looks really bad. Almost £10 per year. an 8 times increase because of the terrible power factor. That is as much as we paid for real power if the light was on permanently for the year. Since I had another separate PIR sensor lying around, I thought it would be a good idea to check its power consumption as well. This one is actually meant for indoor ceiling installation, but I have never used it. As you can see, its data is very similar to the one used by the bulkhead light, slightly less real power but at an even worse power factor. As this sensor is meant for indoor installation, it is not sealed and opening it up is easy. To save time, I took the screws out already. It's a 360 degree sensor for ceilings, and to achieve this coverage, they added 3 sensors, and what looks like an LED is actually the light sensor. The circuit board looks quite neat, but as expected, it uses a standard capacitor dropper to generate the DC power for the electronics. You can see the big blue capacitor acting as a resistor on the upper left next to the square box containing the relay. This arrangement is probably fairly typical for all cheap mains powered electronics, be it LED light bulbs, PIR sensors or timer switches. It seems to me that many devices sold at energy saving may in fact only do so as long as you are not being charged for the high reactive power cycles they produce. As you can see, I decided to go ahead and install the bulkhead light with PIR, and it works well, and no, I'm not on a smart meter yet, but I am considering turning the light permanently off during the summer to reduce power draw, real and apparent. I'm also becoming much more aware of apparent power draw by various devices thanks to my power monitor. If you have not seen it, I add a link to the building of my power monitor into the description below. Thanks for watching.